Hello everyone and welcome back to our channel. So as you are all aware of, we were discussing about the respiratory system. So we have seen the anatomy as well as the physiology of the respiratory system. So the main function of your respiratory system is the respiration, which involves the three processes, that is the pulmonary ventilation, which involves the exchange of gases between the lungs and the atmospheric air. So we have seen how the inhalation and the exhalation takes place. So also respiration involves the exchange of gases between the blood and the alveoli. Blood in the pulmonary capillaries, which are supplying to your lungs, and the alveoli. So this particular process is known as the external respiration. Also the internal respiration, which takes place at the tissue level, wherein the exchange of gases takes place between the blood in the systemic capillary and the tissues. Okay, so this process of respiration, it helps in removing the gaseous waste from the body, that is carbon dioxide, and it provides the oxygen to the tissues. Okay, so we have seen how exactly these exchange of gases take place, why exactly they move in a particular direction is what we have seen in the exchange of gases. So in this particular video, we'll be discussing about the control of this particular process, how this particular process of respiration is regulated. So we have seen that we breathe a specific number of times per minute, right? So we breathe 12 times per minute. So why is it so? What is actually regulating this particular speed of the respiration? And when we are exercising, what happens? This rate of respiration will increase. So why it happens? Why it increases? What makes it increase? So that is what we are going to discuss in this particular video. Okay, so at rest, round about 200 ml of oxygen is utilized by the body cells each minute. But during the strenuous exercise, a lot of oxygen is required by the cells, right? Because they are working more than what they do at rest, right? So this requirement of the oxygen, it increases around about 15 to 20 folds in normal healthy adults, and it can even increase up to 30 folds in the athletes. So what makes it possible to match this requirement? So your demand has increased, so accordingly the rate of respiration also changes, right? So what makes it possible to match this particular respiratory efforts to the metabolic demands? So these mechanisms, there are a number of mechanisms which will help in this particular process. So that is what we are going to discuss in this particular video. So we'll see how exactly the normal respiration is controlled and how exactly it can be altered depending upon the need of the body, and what are the different factors which can affect this rate of respiration. What happens exactly to the rate of respiration because of all these factors? Okay, so coming to the first control over the rate of respiration, that is the respiratory center. So as we have seen in the process of respiration, why inhalation takes place, for any exchange of gases to take place at the alveolar level across your respiratory membrane, first of all, the air should enter into your lungs, right? So what makes it possible for that atmospheric air to enter into your lungs, which is a process of inhalation? Why it takes place? That's because of the changes in the pressure across these areas, right? That is the atmospheric air and your lungs. So the air, it moves towards your lungs due to the pressure difference. So we have seen that the air, it moves from the area of high pressure to the area of low pressure. So during your inhalation, why inhalation takes place? Because the pressure, atmospheric pressure is high and the pressure within the lungs is low. Why it becomes low? That's because of the alteration in the size of the thoracic cavity. So that is altered, right? So we have seen the different laws which are governing this movement of air. Correct? So as the volume increases, the pressure will be lowered. So that is actually responsible for movement of the air in this particular direction. So the alteration in the size of the thorax is actually responsible for the movement of the air, which is made possible by the contraction of certain muscles. The respiratory muscles, diaphragm and the external intercostal muscles, they contract. As a result of which the thoracic cavity increases in the size, pressure is lowered within the lungs and the air will move into the lung. And what happens during the exhalation? The pressure gradients are reversed because the thoracic cavity, the size is reduced. So pressure inside the lungs is high. So it is increased above the atmospheric pressure, because pressure of atmospheric air does not change. So what happens? The air will move out of the lung and exhalation will take place. So why this particular process take place of the inhalation and then the exhalation? What makes it possible to happen? There should be something which will direct these respiratory muscles to contract. So what is that which makes them contract? So this is made possible by the respiratory center. So there are nerve impulses which are transmitted from these respiratory center, which is located in the brain. So as a result of this, the muscles will contract and the thoracic cavity, the size is increased, and it will pull on the lungs and increase the size of the lungs also, as a result of which pressure changes take place. Now during the exhalation, these impulses are not sent. So in the absence of these nerve impulses, the muscles will start relaxing. So we have seen that the inhalation, actually it's an active process because contraction of the muscles is involved. Whereas no such contraction is involved in the exhalation. It's just the relaxation of the muscles which is responsible for the exhalation. That's why the process of exhalation, it is actually a passive process. So all these changes are made possible by this respiratory center. So a cluster of neurons which are located in the medulla oblongata and the pons, which are the parts of the brain stem, these are actually responsible for the ventilation process to take place. Remember the parts of the brain? Can you all recall? There are four parts of the brain, right? The brain stem, cerebellum, the diencephalon, and the cerebrum. So if you can recall the parts of the brain stem, it comprises of three portions, right? The superior part is known as the midbrain, middle portion is known as the pons, and the inferior portion is known as the medulla oblongata, which is in continuation with your spinal cord. So there are some clusters of the neurons in this particular area, that is in your brain stem, which is actually collectively referred to as the respiratory center. So there are three areas which function as the respiratory center, which will control the respiration, the rate of respiration which takes place. So these three areas are the medullary rhythmicity area. This is the one. So it is located in the medulla oblongata, right? The second area is the pneumotaxis area, which is located in the pons. This is the one. And the third one is the apneustic area, which is also located in the pons. Okay, so out of the three portions of your brain stem, the respiratory center is located in the pons and the medulla oblongata. So coming to the first area, that is the medullary rhythmicity area. Now the function of this particular area is to control the basic rhythm of the respiration. So you breathe 12 times per minute is because of this medullary rhythmicity area. So it sends the impulses for a specific period of time, then it stops sending the impulses. So this process repeats cyclically. So that's why inhalation, exhalation, and then again inhalation and exhalation, it will take place. And you breathe a specific number of times. So that is made possible by this particular area. Now within this medullary rhythmicity area, there are two areas actually it is comprised of. That is inspiratory area and the expiratory area. These are the ones. Both are located in the medulla oblongata. Okay, now let us see how exactly these two areas function in maintaining the basic rhythm of the respiration or the breathing. Now let's talk about the quiet breathing first. Okay, so rate of respiration is different during quiet breathing and during strenuous exercise, right? So let us see how exactly the rhythm is maintained during quiet breathing when you are at rest. Now when you are at rest, the inhalation, it lasts for about 2 seconds, and the exhalation, it lasts a little longer, that's about 3 seconds. So you can just try it out, just focus on your breathing and just see for how long you inhale and for how long you exhale. Don't control it by yourself. So you can also control it very well, but check out what is the normal breathing rate which takes place. You inhale for 2 seconds and then you exhale for a little longer if you can focus on your breathing. Now why it happens? Why do you inhale for 2 seconds and then you exhale for 3 seconds? Why it happens? That's because of this inspiratory area. Remember, this respiratory center, it sends certain impulses to your muscles, right? Respiratory muscles. So this inspiratory area, when it is active, it is activated for how long? For 2 seconds. So when it is active, it sends the impulses to the muscles. Now, which are the muscles which are involved during the inhalation? Yes, these are the external intercostal muscles and the diaphragm. So how these impulses will reach these muscles? The external intercostal muscles, these are supplied by intercostal nerves. So these nerves will send the impulses to the external intercostal muscles, and the phrenic nerve, this supplies the diaphragm. So it will send the impulses to your diaphragm. So this inspiratory area, via these two nerves, intercostal nerves and the phrenic nerves, so it will send the impulses to the external intercostal muscles and the diaphragm respectively. So what will happen as a result of this? These two muscles, they will contract. So as they contract, what will happen? Diaphragm descends downward, right? It's a dome shaped. It's a dome shaped structure. So it becomes flatter. So it increases the vertical diameter of your thoracic cavity. And the external intercostals, which are present in between the ribs, as they contract, they will elevate the ribs. So as a result of this, the lateral diameter as well as the anterior posterior diameter will increase. So as a result of this, the volume of the thoracic cavity is increased. They will pull on the lungs. So as a result of this, pressure will be decreased within the lungs and the air will move into the lungs. So inhalation will take place. What type of inhalation? That is the normal quiet inhalation will take place. But when there are no nerve impulses which are reaching these muscles of respiration, that is when this inspiratory area, it becomes inactive. So it remains inactive for 3 seconds. So as a result of this, since there is no stimulation which is being sent towards the diaphragm and the external intercostal muscles, they will start relaxing. So as a result of which, what will happen? Elastic recoil of the lungs will take place. So the volume will reduce of the thoracic cavity and ultimately the lungs. So as a result of which, the pressure inside will increase above the atmospheric air pressure and the exhalation will take place. That is the normal quiet exhalation will take place. Okay. So after the inhalation has taken place for the 2 seconds, the exhalation will take place for round about 3 seconds, because there are no nerve impulses being sent by the inspiratory area towards the muscles of the inhalation. Okay. So the passive elastic recoil of your lungs will take place and the thoracic wall, and the exhalation will take place. So at the end of the 3 seconds, so once the exhalation is done, again the cycle will repeat. That is, the inspiratory area, it will be active. It will send the impulses to your diaphragm and the external intercostals. They will contract and inhalation will take place for 2 seconds. So it repeats rhythmically. So this is made possible by the inspiratory area. Now, what is the role of this expiratory area then? So usually during quiet breathing, it remains inactive. It has no role in quiet breathing. But as the forceful breathing begins, the inspiratory area, no doubt it will be active. Now, in addition to the muscles of the inhalation, it will also stimulate the accessory muscles. Remember these, the diaphragm, it will contract more forcefully. Apart from this, the sternocleidomastoid muscle and the scalene muscle. So, this particular muscle will raise the sternum more than what happens usually. And the scalene muscles, these are the ones which are present in between the first two ribs. So, it will elevate the first two ribs more than usual. So, diaphragm will descend down more, that is up to 10 centimeters. So that the forceful inhalation can take place. So this is how the forceful inhalation will take place. Now how the forceful exhalation takes place? Now remember when we had discussed about the forceful exhalation, additional muscles of the exhalation will contract. Now why it is happening? That's because the inspiratory area is activating this expiratory area also. So what will happen? This expiratory area, it will send the impulses to internal intercostal muscles, which are not usually contracting during quiet breathing. But during the strenuous exercise or forceful breathing, the internal intercostal muscles also will contract. Apart from that, abdominal muscles will also contract. So, as a result of this, what will happen? The contraction of internal intercostals, it will pull the ribs downwards more than usual so that the size will decrease. Apart from that, abdominal muscles as they contract, they push on the diaphragm so that the thoracic cavity size is decreased more than usual. So, greater pressure changes will take place than what takes place during quiet breathing. So, as a result of this, more forceful exhalation will take place because pressure increases much more than what happens during the quiet breathing. Okay, so this is how the forceful exhalation will take place. Now, the next area, so this is the role of medullary rhythmicity area. Now, the next area is the pneumotaxic area. Now, usually we have seen that the medullary rhythmicity area, it takes care of the basic rhythm of respiration, right? During quiet breathing as well as forceful breathing. Now, what is the role of these additional two areas then? So, these two areas help in coordinating the transition between the inhalation and the exhalation. So, why, what makes that inspiratory area activate or inactivate? It's by these two areas. So, they are actually controlling the normal pace of the respiration which takes place. So, this pneumotaxic area, pneumo means air and the taxic means arrangement, air or breathe. So, this is present in the upper pons. And actually this area, pneumotaxic area, it is sending the inhibitory impulses to the inspiratory area. Now, inspiratory area is responsible for inhalation to take place, right? So, what will happen when this is inhibited by the pneumotaxic area? What will happen? So, as a result of this, it will turn off the inspiratory area, right? It is inhibiting the inspiratory area before the lungs become too much filled with the air. So, it prevents the overinflation of your lungs. So, this is the reason why it stops at the 2 seconds. After 2 seconds, the pneumotaxic area, it will send the inhibitory impulses towards your inspiratory area so that the impulses which are sent by the inspiratory area to the muscles, it will stop. So, it will shorten the duration of inhalation. So, what will happen if excessive activation by this pneumotaxic area will take place? If it is more active, what will happen? the inhalation, it will be shortened than the 2 seconds. So what will happen to the breathing rate? The duration of your inhalation and exhalation will decrease. So the number of times you breathe, that will increase. So breathing rate will become more rapid. Then the next area is the apneustic area, which is located in the lower regions of your pons. So this is again involved in coordinating the transition between inhalation and the exhalation. So this area actually sends the stimulatory impulses to your inspiratory area. So the pneumotaxic area, it sends the inhibitory impulses, and the apneustic area, it sends the stimulatory impulses to your inspiratory area. So what will happen? So apneustic area is activating this inspiratory area during the inhalation. So what will happen? As it activates, the inhalation will get prolonged. So as a result of this, long and deep inhalation will take place. So when this area will remain active for a longer period of time, it overrides the signals from the apneustic area. So this is to do with the control of the respiration by the respiratory center. Now there are certain other mechanisms which are actually regulating the respiratory center itself. Respiratory center is responsible for the basic rhythm of the respiration, right? But these in turn can be modified in response to certain inputs from the other regions of the brain or the receptors from the peripheral nervous system or certain other factors also. So they may in turn alter the activities of the respiratory center. So coming to the first influence, that is from the cortical centers, the higher centers. So actually the respiratory center, it is located in the brain stem, right? But there are certain higher centers which in turn can regulate the respiratory center because it has connections. So this is the reason why you can voluntarily alter the pattern of breathing. You can even hold your breath, right, for some time. So this voluntary control is actually protective in nature. So that will prevent any water or any liquids or any irritating gases from entering into your lungs. Supposing if you go for swimming, so what do? You hold your breath, right? Otherwise what will happen? The water will enter your respiratory system. So that can be prevented by voluntary control of the respiration. Supposing if you encounter some irritating gases in your laboratory, what happens? You immediately stop breathing, right? So that will help in preventing any irritating gases from entering your lungs. So this ability to not breathe, this is however limited. You can't hold your breath beyond certain limits, right? That's because of the buildup of the carbon dioxide and the H plus in the body. So it will increase the amount of carbon dioxide and obviously the acidity. Partial pressure of carbon dioxide will increase. The acidity will increase. On the other hand, we have seen why acidity increases. Carbon dioxide, it combines with water, isn't it? CO2, it combines with water in presence of carbonic anhydrase to produce the carbonic acid, which can easily split into H plus and the bicarbonate ions. So buildup of acidity will take place. So up to certain level it can be tolerated. Beyond that, inspiratory area will be strongly stimulated. And it will send the impulses through your phrenic and intercostal nerves to the inspiratory muscles, and the breathing will resume. even if you hold your breath beyond this, it will result in fainting. After some time you will faint, and once you faint you lose your consciousness, automatically the breathing will resume. So you can't hold your breath, you can't kill yourself by holding the breath. It's not possible. It's not possible at all. Apart from this, even the nerve impulses from the hypothalamus limbic system, these also can stimulate the respiratory center. So during any emotional stimuli, the respiration alters, right? Say for example, when you're laughing or crying, your rate of respiration is altered, right? Your breathing pattern is altered. That's because of the influence of hypothalamus and the limbic system on your respiratory center. And the next type of control is the chemoreceptor regulation of the respiration. So certain chemical stimuli may also alter how quickly you breathe or how deeply you breathe. Now, which are these chemicals which can be sensed? So these will be the carbon dioxide and the oxygen, as well as the H plus levels. So these are continuously regulated and there are sensory neurons which will be responsive towards these levels of these chemicals, and such receptors are known as the chemoreceptors. And there are chemoreceptors which are present at two locations which are continuously monitoring the levels of carbon dioxide, H plus and oxygen, so that it provides the input to your respiratory center. So the ones which are located in your CNS, that is in the medulla oblongata in your CNS, these are called as central chemoreceptors. So these are continuously monitoring the levels of H plus and the CO2 or both in the CSF. So these will send the signal to your respiratory center which is located. Apart from that, in the periphery also these chemoreceptors are located. These are known as peripheral chemoreceptors. So these are located at two places, the aortic bodies and the carotid bodies. So aortic bodies, as the name implies, these are the clusters of chemoreceptors which are present in the arch of aorta. If you can recall your CVS also, you must be familiar with these terms. So aortic bodies are continuously sensing the levels of the carbon dioxide or the oxygen and the H plus levels. So if there is any alteration, it will send a signal to the respiratory center. Apart from that, the carotid bodies, which are located in the common carotid artery, just where it splits into internal and external carotid artery, are present the carotid bodies. So this in turn are sensing the levels of these chemicals, and if there is any alteration, they will send the signal towards the respiratory center. Okay, so now usually what is the level of partial pressure of carbon dioxide? It is 40 mmHg. Now even slight increase in this partial pressure, that is a condition called as hypercapnia or a hypercarbia, it is known as. So this will result in stimulation of central chemoreceptors as well as the peripheral chemoreceptors. In addition to that, the peripheral chemoreceptors will also sense the deficiency of oxygen, that is known as the hypoxia. So as a result of any disturbance in the homeostasis, by increasing the arterial partial pressure of carbon dioxide or decreasing the pH, that is increase in the acidity, or decrease in the partial pressure of oxygen, these are sensed by the central as well as peripheral chemoreceptors. It will send the impulses to your control center, that is your inspiratory area in the medulla oblongata. So what will happen? It will result in stimulation of the muscles of the inhalation and exhalation. So as a result of increasing these levels, now it has to be brought back to normal, right? So how you can decrease the level of carbon dioxide? Yes, by increasing the rate of breathing, right? So it can be removed out of the body. So this condition is called as hyperventilation, rapid and deep breathing. So it will allow to inhale more oxygen, so more and more oxygen will be taken up and more carbon dioxide will be exhaled out until these levels come back to normal. So this is how it will help in the homeostasis. On the contrary, if the partial pressure of carbon dioxide, if it is lower than 40 mmHg, below normal, this condition is called as hypocapnia or hypocarbia. So what will happen because of this? Again, the homeostasis is disturbed, right? So again, the central and the peripheral chemoreceptors, they will sense this. The levels are below normal. So now what will happen? They are not stimulated. These chemoreceptors are not stimulated. So as a result of this, the stimulation will not take place. So as a result of this, these nerve impulses which are being sent to your inspiratory area, that will not take place. So these are not sent. So when the impulses do not reach inspiratory area, the nerve impulses to your muscles of inhalation and exhalation, these are also not sent. So what will happen? The hyperventilation, that will come back to normal. So as a result of this, the breathing rate is brought back to normal. And the next type of control is the proprioceptor stimulation of the respiration. Now, when you are exercising or when you are carrying out some strenuous activity, what happens to your rate of respiration? Does it wait till your oxygen level goes down or carbon dioxide levels goes up or H plus levels goes up? Will it wait till all these happen? No, as soon as you start exercising, the depth of breathing increases, right? Even before the levels of these change. So why this is happening? That's because of the stimulus which is sent by the proprioceptors. Remember the proprioceptors, these are the sensory receptors which are monitoring the movements of the joints and muscles, the position and the movements. Now when these joints and muscles, these are carrying out more strenuous activities as during exercise, these proprioceptors will sense this movement. So nerve impulses from these proprioceptors will stimulate the inspiratory area of your medulla oblongata. So as a result of this, what will happen? Your rate of respiration will increase. At the same time, the axon collaterals, that is the branches of the upper motor neurons, which are originating in the primary motor cortex, this is also stimulated. So as a result of this, it will send the impulses towards the inspiratory area for more rapid breathing to take place. Then one more control is the inflation reflex. Just like in the blood vessels, you'll have the baroreceptors, right, or the stretch receptors, which are continuously monitoring the stretching of your blood vessels. So if there is overstretching of your blood vessels, what will happen? There will be changes in the diameter, right? So stretching will take place. So overstretching can be sensed by these baroreceptors. So similar type of stretch receptors are also present in the walls of the bronchi and the bronchioles, because the diameter of your bronchi and bronchioles also alter as the air is flowing through, right? So when there is excessive stretching, when the lungs become overinflated, there will be stretching of these walls of your bronchi and bronchioles, right? So as a result of this, baroreceptors will be stimulated and they will send the impulses through the vagus nerve, which is a 10th cranial nerve. So this will send the impulses to your inspiratory area and the apneustic area. Now inspiratory area will be inhibited, so the rate of respiration will be slowed down. And what is the role of your apneustic area? It stimulates the inspiratory area, right? So this apneustic area is also inhibited. As a result of this, the activation of this inspiratory area in turn is reduced. So as a result of this, exhalation will begin. So the overinflation of your lungs is prevented. So as the air will leave the lungs now, during the exhalation, what will happen? The lungs will start deflating. Just your balloon, if you release it, the air will come out, right? So same thing will happen over here. Otherwise, what will happen? Overinflation of your lungs will result in bursting, right? So that should be prevented. So that is taken care of by this inflation reflex. So as the lungs deflate, the stretch receptors will no longer be stimulated. So there won't be any impulses, inhibitory impulses towards the apneustic or inspiratory area. So again, a new cycle of inhalation will begin. So this reflex is known as the inflation reflex or Herring-Bruce reflex. So this is protective in nature to prevent the excessive inflation of your lungs. Now, apart from these mechanisms, there are certain other influences on the respiration. So some other factors also may contribute to regulate the respiration. So these include the limbic system stimulation, the temperature, pain, stretching and of the anal sphincter muscles, irritation of the airways and the blood pressure. So let's take up all these one by one. So limbic system stimulation. So any emotion or any anticipatory activity, say for example you have a stage appearance, your heart starts beating fast, right? Your rate of respiration will also increase. So why this happens? That's because of the impulses sent by the limbic system towards your inspiratory area. So it sends the excitatory input. So as a result of this, rate and depth of ventilation will increase. Next factor is the temperature. So increase in the body temperature, as occurs during fever or vigorous muscular activity, heat production takes place. So it increases the rate of respiration. So what will happen when the body temperature decreases? It will decrease the rate of respiration. And a sudden cold stimulus, it will result in temporary apnea. That is, you'll stop breathing, absence of breathing. A means without, pnea means breathe. So you'll stop breathing. Then the next factor is the pain. So sudden and severe pain, it will result in brief apnea, that is cessation of breathing. And the prolonged somatic pain, it will increase the rate of respiration. Whereas the visceral pain, that is from the viscera, internal organs, it will slow the rate of respiration. Next factor is the stretching the anal sphincter muscle. So anal sphincter, which is present in the anus of the rectum, so as a result of the stretching of this anal sphincter muscles, increases the rate of respiration. So it may be used sometimes when the newborn baby or a particular person stops breathing. So stimulation of these anal sphincter muscles may also stimulate the respiration. Next factor is irritation of the airways. So any physical or chemical irritation of the pharynx or the larynx, it may result in immediate cessation of breathing. Immediately, if any irritant substance enters your respiratory tract, you immediately stop breathing, right? Which may be followed by coughing or sneezing to remove any accidental entry of any such irritant substance. And the next factor is the blood pressure. So carotid and aortic baroreceptors, these detect the changes in the blood pressure. So a sudden rise in the blood pressure, it decreases the rate of respiration. And a decrease in the blood pressure, it increases the rate of respiration. Okay, so these are the factors which are controlling the respiration. So we have seen the respiratory center, which comprises of medullary rhythmicity area, inspiratory and expiratory area, the apneustic area and the pneumotaxic area, how it controls the medullary rhythmicity area or the inspiratory area. So also we have seen the different influences apart from the respiratory center, how respiratory center can be influenced by other factors and how the rate of respiration can be altered by the other factors. Okay, so this is the reference. Thank you for watching.